putting a schedule before God that I'll get to church once a week when it's convenient for me and my family and kids. Well, you can be a lay member and do that, and that still doesn't mean you're justified. But you certainly can't do it calling yourself an apostolic minister. It won't work in the sight of God. You. I'm not supposed to preach me. I'm supposed to preach Christ Jesus the Lord, and we as ministers, servants for his sake. And this is what people are supposed to come and hear. See, what has to happen is for the break to take place for evangelism and outreach and for growth is the ministers of the Greater Bible Temple and all of our churches have to get out of this routine of thinking that they can craft a schedule that they find convenient for themselves and then put it before God and say, I'll get there to do what your workload when I get around to it. When they start sacrificing according to the scriptures, then we'll see fruit come forth according to scriptures. Because the apostles and Jesus Christ did not craft an agenda that was convenient for themselves. They gave themselves. Jesus Christ gave himself a ransom. He sacrificed his entire life. The apostles were all martyrs except for one. So there is no model for you in 21st century Christianity to use to justify yourself putting a schedule before God that I'll get to church once a week when it's convenient for me and my family and kids. Well, you can be a lay member and do that. And that still doesn't mean you're justified. But you certainly can't do it calling yourself an apostolic minister. It won't work in the sight of God. Praise the Lord. You may do it, but you're out of order. Okay, verse number 6. For God, who commanded the light to shine out of darkness, have shined in our hearts to give the light of the knowledge of the glory of God in the face of who? So, I mean, he has shined out of darkness in our hearts. How many ministers? Let me see the hands. God is supposed to be shining out of darkness in your hearts, which is where you determine your will, your purpose, and what you're going to do and who you're going to be. This is where you make your final resolve. Our final resolve is made in our hearts. I am resolved what to do. You reach your final resolve. Someone say, in our hearts. So you're going to have to wrestle with this after I finish teaching. And the wrestling is for all of you that are called to preach. Stop trying to craft an agenda that's convenient for you and then present it to God like he's going to accept it. Your schedule has to be God's schedule. God is not accepting your schedule to show up when you want to and not show up when you don't want to if you're a minister. Because what follows the teaching is God backing it up. All right? Verse number 7, read. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that is the ministers, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. This is what God wants to demonstrate. When you allow God to use you to bring a person to salvation, they come, they get water baptized in Jesus' name. You pray for them and they receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You can't give anyone the Holy Spirit, neither can I. So it shows what is in you, it shows what is in me, and the excellency of the power of God is manifest that after we speak the word, he backs it up and gives them the baptism of the power of the Holy Spirit. But the same thing goes with healing and miracles. How many have prayed for someone? They've been healed. Well, I mean, it said every believer shall lay hands on the sick and they. So there's power in prayer. There's power in you through the Holy Spirit to pray for someone and they get healed. Praise the Lord. If you're a minister, it is a sign that is supposed to follow every believer. Most certainly those who are called to the ministry. Praise the Lord. And I could ask additional questions. But anyway, this is a treasure. The treasure is the light that shines out of darkness in our hearts to give light of the knowledge of the glory of God in Christ Jesus in verse number 6. This is the treasure that is in us. It is the power of God, the word of God, the spirit of God that's in us that manifests itself through the truth that he spoke of in verse number 2. So you have no right to be a minister to have these things in you and refuse to make them available whenever God says they ought to be made available. Not I will get to Bible class Friday when I get around to it. But you have accepted all these things God put in you. And these things don't belong to you. They belong to God. So you're supposed to be at the house of God to make them available to whoever God sends to the house of God whenever he sends them. You certainly can't say God has not been sending them, because over a period of 37 years at this church, we have baptized over 7,800 people in Jesus' name. And over 4,000 have received the gift of the Holy Spirit. So what are you talking about? We've had hundreds and thousands of healings, miracles. Sister Leah died twice and came back alive. What are you going to do? Sit up here and roll your eyes at me? Are you serious? I mean, here, it's almost as though somebody's on drugs around here, because you mean to tell me all these things God has done, and you're, I think Brother Adams said they told him he had this, he said, forget you, he laid hands on himself and got healed. Now, if you did this, you can't sit up and talk about what God hasn't put in you, and you owe it to make it available to whoever God said make it available to whenever they need to receive it, because you had it made available to you. Praise the Lord. Thank you, Jesus. So I'm talking to us. We claim we're ministers. We're going to have to we need to operate like ministers and stop operating like sinners. Sinners operate on their own time. They do whatever they are big enough to do when they are big, and they don't tell me what to do. Well, God tells a saint what to do, and a true saint will do what God says do. So they won't be arguing with me. All I'm saying is show up to do what God has saved you to do. Get on your post. Praise the Lord. All right. So we have this treasure in earthen vessels, that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. The power is not of us. The power is of who? All right. Now I'll let you read the rest of this that he speaks of, because this he speaks of Sister Briston. Because this is what they were going through in that day. The trials and tribulations in that day is that they were troubled. They were perplexed. They were persecuted. They were bearing in their body the dying of the Lord Jesus. This is what they were doing in that day. But we are not in the era of persecution. We are in the era of deception. The scripture is, ye all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. Then Paul said, but evil men and seducers shall wax worse and worse, deceiving and being deceived. So the order of our day is not persecution. The order of our day is deception. And I'm teaching against deception tonight and saying that don't deceive yourself. If you're called to the ministry, the few times you're asked to be here to minister and to bring others to hear the word of God, because many of us have been instrumental in bringing people to be saved, then they show up and we're not here. And it leaves the impression to a newborn babe that Bible class is not important because you brought them in, they got saved, but you're not here. And mind you me, preachers, if that person backslides because they saw you and you were not faithful, that person's blood's going to be on your hands. You're going to answer for that. when all you have to do is put your pride down and show up for an hour. As Jesus said, couldn't you pray with me for an hour? You couldn't show up for 1 hour? So think about what you're doing, preachers. Turn to someone and say, think about what you're doing, preachers. Let's go to the sixth chapter of the same book, and I'm going to let you go. Trying to help you as ministers so you can stop trying to be a 21st century cool breeze minister. Can we say amen? The church doesn't have any room for Beyonce ministers. Can we say amen? Or what's the girl that just got through singing and the microphone went off on her? Mariah Carey. Well, he sabotaged me. But they paid their money. Praise the Lord. The thing is, this is not what we do in the church. We're not here to entertain anyone. Praise the Lord. And giving one their money's worth. We're here to give diligence to make our what? So we need to put away the celebrityism and take on the spirit of a servant. Jesus put off the garments of kingship and took on the garments of humility and humbled himself and became obedient unto death. And that's really what the ministers need to do. The old man in the ministers needs to die so the new man can come forth and live to the glory of God and Jesus Christ. This is the struggle. All right, in the sixth chapter, verses 1 through verse number 10, read. We then as workers together with him. So ministers, what are we supposed to be? You're not supposed to be worrying about what Bishop Combs thinks. You're supposed to be working together with him, thinking about Brother Zach, what God thinks about your faithfulness. Now remember, faith cometh by hearing the word of. So think about that. If the word of God is being taught from this, by the Holy Spirit through the minister, the preacher, the pastor. It is the Holy Spirit. It's the word of God. And I say, I don't want to hear it. So I'm not going to Bible class tonight. I'm not doing it. I don't have to do all that. Remember, you're saying you don't have to hear the word of God. And unless you are in a position of superiority to the person who is teaching, that is not an affront to me. That's an affront to God and his word. That's not a put off of Bishop Combs. It's a putting off of the word of God. And the church say amen. And you're refusing to work with God. Just see it here. We then as workers together with him. So what's your problem if you're a preacher working with God? Why can't you work with God? Now you think about that. I'm going to ask you another question. How many of you have worked with God? The person got up at the altar call, got baptized in Jesus' name. Let's just take that. And they got baptized. I want to see the hands. So you were working with God, and someone came and got baptized in God's name. Then afterwards, you worked with them, and God bore witness and gave them the gift of, you see the hands. Well, brothers and sisters, what are you talking about? At the end of every service, we're making an altar call for people to come and get baptized in God's name and to receive what? God's Spirit. And they cannot do that unless I've taught the, or somebody's preached the word of. So why, what is it that we don't understand in the equation about working with God? What is it that we don't get? We then, as workers together with him, read, beseech or beg you also that ye receive not the grace of God in vain. He's going to explain. Turn to someone and say, is he going to explain? Yes. For he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted, in the day of salvation. I have succored, means I have helped thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Behold, now is the day of. This has to do with working with him to bring people to. Brothers and sisters, it couldn't be more clear in bringing people to salvation. I agree. that when G. Craig Lewis comes down, when Bishop Hanna comes down, when Wow comes down, when any of these four missions come down, we should get together, get people in here so they can hear the word of God to be what? But we should do that every time there's an opportunity. Not for a special occasion. Not just for a special occasion. And you can't say that this occasion is more important than that occasion, because look what he just said. I have heard thee in a time accepted. The occasion is when he decides it's time for him to save somebody. And that could be 6 o'clock in the morning for you to get up out of the bed and go take somebody down to the church to receive the Holy Ghost. And what, you gonna tell God, I'm asleep? As a minister, I'm telling you now, you will not get off. God will not let you off the hook. And in this church, Sister Briston, Sister Trevor, others, they know we have had people come down to this church all types of day and night to get baptized, and God fill them with. So what are you talking about? Did you ever think about when you put your program on, when you get finished preaching, it's about 10:30 anyway. By the time you finish with the altar call, Brother Jeffrey, and everybody get through talking, it's 12 midnight. You don't think about how much time that takes? But we think because it's a crowd and everybody is engaging, it's more important than coming down here on a time when it's two or three folks. But the persons who are witnessing Brother Vosky to two or three people and they're getting baptized and filled are just as important in the work that they're doing as the person bringing in 1,000 people. Because this is how we receive not the grace of God in vain. How so? For he saith, I have heard thee in a time accepted. In the day of salvation, I have helped thee. Behold, now is the accepted time. Time to do what? To work with God. To bring people where? To salvation. So brothers and sisters, some of us have a misconception of how serious this is. It is not about me coming looking at you, you looking at me. This is about bringing people to salvation. These people out here are dying in their sins, mind you me. Now then verse number 3 is powerful read. He says, giving no offense in anything that the ministry be not blamed. You don't want the ministry to be blamed because you don't want to interfere with people coming to be saved. You don't want to interfere with it being the accepted time and it being the day of salvation. So you want to make certain that you and I are not doing things to interfere with our work with God to bring men and women and boys and girls to salvation. And when we don't show up and call ourselves ministers while we're sitting at home tomorrow, I'm tired, we are causing the ministry to be blamed. Well, I can't make it, but yes, you can. If you can go to work every day, you can get on your post as a minister when that door opens up. Now, you may not do it, but you can do it if you want to. And God's not going to come down and strike you with lightning. Can we say amen? He's not going to do that. That's not the day we live in. He's going to use the pastor to teach you, and then he's going to take it from there. So the ministry be not blamed. Verse 4, but in all things approving ourselves as the ministers of God. So what are we supposed to do? Now, you don't need my approval. You know what you need to do? You need to approve yourself. You need your own approval. You said you called to the ministry, then approve yourself. Now, there's a way to do it. This is what he's going to outline. He's going to outline some almost 23 things you have to do to approve yourself. Want to pat yourself on the back? Let's do it like this. In much patience. The first thing Combs approves himself in is what? Patience. How do you get patience? Tribulation, work of patience. So if you're going to have much patience, then you're going to have to be willing as a preacher to go through much tribulation. Not just tribulation, much tribulation. Well, and this is where most of them stop. Most preachers stop right there because most preachers don't want any tribulation. They don't want trials. They don't want troubles. They want to say they're a preacher, grab a briefcase, put on a robe, get a handkerchief when they're preaching and sweat, or get up and preach and sound good, and people tell them that they preach well. No, the way Combs approves himself is in much patience. That means Combs has to go through much tribulation. The next one is in what? In afflictions. The Bible said many afflictions are the righteous, but the Lord delivereth out of them. So preachers do not want afflictions. But brothers and sisters, this is how Combs approves himself. He has to go through afflictions. And Paul is simply talking about what he went through. In one place he said, God forbid, but that I speak of those things which God had wrought by mine own hands. Paul is the one that went through afflictions. Paul is the one that was stoned and left for dead. Paul that was the one that was beaten with many stripes three times. 39 stripes save one. So he is simply speaking from personal experience. Much afflictions, or in afflictions, read, in necessities. You need to read, he was in situations where he did not have what he needed in necessities, hence he had to wait on God to provide the things that were necessary. An example would be when there was dearth in Jerusalem, and Agabus prophesied it would be a famine. So he had to go around and collect offerings for the saints of Jerusalem to help them deal with the poverty. An example would be the work we do in foreign fields. I didn't have to go into Venezuela or Dominican or to Haiti or to Chile or all these other places I went to do foreign missions work. I was asked to do it. I said, okay. I was asked for money. I gave it. I met the necessities of others as well as myself. But I could have sat back and said, I'm not doing it. I would have had to pay a price for it, but I could have done it. Number three, necessities. So this has to do with us suffering in need of our necessities and waiting on God and assisting to meet the necessities of others. Preachers. Someone say preachers. In distresses. Paul was in distress. Praise the Lord. So if you're in distress, this is an opportunity when you're in distress. Well, I've never been going through so much hell since I've been called to the ministry. Good for you. For this is what you're supposed to go through when you are called to the ministry. You're supposed to go through hell like the rest of us. You're supposed to suffer just like the rest of us. It's all a part of the process. Praise the Lord. But I'm at home, I'm going through. Everybody goes through something. You're not the only one got problems in your marriage. You're not the only one got problems with finances. You're not the only one trying to make ends meet to meet bills. Everyone is going through something. Can we say amen? All right. In stripes, that Paul was beaten with stripes. And imprisonments, Paul was put in prison. That's number six. In tumults, there were riots. He had to let him over the wall, get him out of the city before they killed him. It was labors. He had to labor as a tent maker. In watchings, he had to watch to see if those who were after him, the Jews who followed him from city to city, to kill him. In fasting, he fasted 14 days. Remember, he was going to Rome and the shipwreck on the island of Miletus. It's in your Bible. In fastings, by pureness. So he is saying in things and by things. By pureness, that is tumults is number 7. Labors is number 8. Watchings is number 9. Fastings is number 10. Verse 6. Pureness is number 11. Knowledge is number 12. By pureness, because that's supposed to be what is in the believer. We're supposed to be pure. By knowledge, that is the knowledge of God. by long-suffering, that is the long-suffering God, by kindness, that is the loving kindness of God, by the Holy Spirit, that's the Spirit of God, by love unfeigned, that's the agape of God, that is showing the appropriate, I'm going to close with this, my time is up, showing the appropriate approbation or value to everyone you come in contact with based on not the way you see them, but the way God sees them. That's why I don't have a problem dealing straight up with everybody, because it's not my job to look at people through the prism of my own assessment and philosophy. I have to remember that but for the grace of God, there go I. So I don't look down on anyone. The old saying is never to look down on a person except, or never look down on a brother except to lift him up. So I'm going to stop there. Preachers, somebody say preachers. This is your lesson for tonight. I'll get back to it next week. I apologize I wasn't here. As I already mentioned, my flight was out of commission. But you and I, and this includes me, we have to approve ourselves. The approval is not seeking the approval of someone else in this text. This is now seeking to approve yourself. And you do not have the right to use your standard. I just gave you 12 of the things the Word of God says you have to use to approve yourself. So it's not for you to look in the mirror and say, well, I'm a preacher of the greater Bible. When I get there, if I go there, I go. If I don't, I don't. You ain't following no scriptures. That's you talking. That's not the Holy Spirit. So if you're going to approve yourself, you have to use the standard of God to do that. And if you can't meet the standard of God, if Combs can't meet the standard of God, Reverend Jackson, then I'm not approved. I'm not even approved by myself. I'm disapproved based on the standard that God gave me to use to approve myself. I most certainly are not improved in the sight of God. So we have to become more introspective. We have to become less about comparing ourselves to who ain't in Bible class. If you're a minister, it doesn't matter. Are you here? And you need to what? Approve yourself. I'm the bishop of the diocese. I'm here all the time. I'm fascinated that people who are under me, they think they're better than me. They think I have to be here to teach, but they can come once a week. Isn't that deep? I'm the Dawson Bishop, the highest ranking member in the PAW, in the body of Christ in Michigan. And people sitting under me think they are so much better than I am that God has ordained me to show up, prepare a lesson to teach his people, that they will understand that now is the accepted time. The day is the what? Day of salvation. They're supposed to be working with God. We're all supposed to be working with God. I'm up here doing the job God gave me to do, and they can stay home and say, I don't feel like coming. I was there the other day. I won't be back.